I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and stood at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. joys and concerns. So happy birthday to Tammy East, who celebrates her birthday tomorrow. Bill Gulliver and Cindy McPherson, who celebrate their birthdays on Tuesday. And Joanne Johnson, who celebrates her birthday on Wednesday. And happy anniversary to Scott and Sean Gulliver, who celebrate their anniversary on Wednesday. We need to be in prayer for Becky and Chris's granddaughter, Zoe. She's having her second MRI. They're trying to get to the bottom of some health issues that she's having. So please, prayers for them, for Zoe, for her family, for wisdom and discernment for the doctors. Continued prayers for Alan Lacey, who's undergoing treatment for cancer. Prayers also lifted for all those who continue to struggle with health issues and for those who are healing from surgery. And we continue to lift up all those who are continuing to deal with devastation from storms, fires, and all those who are dealing with the effects of violence. Let us enter into a time of silent prayer. Our most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning thanking you and praising you for this day. Father, we are so grateful that you know our needs so much better than we do. So we thank you for the rain that you've sent. And we thank you for all the hints of fall in the air and what that will bring with it. Father, we thank you for the joys that have been lifted today, for all those milestones that we share with one another. But we are mindful of the names and situations that weigh heavy on our hearts. Father, you are the great physician. You've created each and every one of us, and you know our needs so much better than we do. So we bring them to you. And we ask, Father, that you hear us. We ask your hand upon all those who are dealing with health issues, for those who are in recovery from surgery. We ask for wisdom and discernment for the doctors, and we thank you for all of those who are caring for them. Father, we lift up the men and women who are serving this country, whether at home or abroad. All of our first responders, we thank you for their willingness to serve. We lift up the leadership of this congregation and for me as pastor as we vision together our future. And then, Father, we just ask that you envelop us in your peace, that you give us the courage and strength that we need to do the work that you are calling us to do. Now, Father, we raise our voices together as one as we pray the prayer your Son taught, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Will you join in me in the prayer or the hymn of preparation, Jesus Savior, Pilot Me, hymn number 509.
Thank you.
Will you join me in the prayer of illumination? Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our scripture this morning comes from Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. Matthew 14, 22 to 33. Hear these words. Immediately he made the disciples get into a boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the inspiration of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Our daughter Kelly was given an assignment, and I don't remember now if she was in fifth or sixth grade, but I do remember that she was required to choose a topic as well as a book that was written on that particular topic. And after reading the book, she was then to write a book report. Kelly chose the Holocaust, and I believe the book that she chose was entitled The Diary of Anne Frank. That book report began a longtime passion in Kelly to read everything that she could about the Holocaust. Despite the fact that there are many that are trying to deny that the Holocaust actually happened, there are a number of books and papers written by individuals who had survived the Holocaust. There is also now the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. that has many, many items and stories that have come from survivors and families of those survivors. From their website, I read this, and I quote, "Today we face an alarming rise in Holocaust denial and anti-Semitism, even in the very lands where the Holocaust happened, as well as genocide and thoughts of genocide in other parts of the world. This is occurring just as we approach a time when Holocaust survivors and other eyewitnesses will no longer be alive." Since its dedication in 1993, the museum has welcomed more than 47 million visitors, including 100 heads of state, and more than 11 million school-age children. Our Holocaust Encyclopedia, the world's leading online authority on the Holocaust, is available in 19 different languages and was visited in 2021 by more than 21 million people representing 238 countries and territories, end quote. Think about how much you and I have learned because people were brave enough to put it on paper. However, think about what we would have missed about the history of the Jewish people had those events never been written down. From the beginning of time, individuals have passed on the history of their family, either by word of mouth in the telling of stories or putting pen to paper. It's how we pass on our heritage from generation to generation. And all you have to do is sit around a dinner table with family and you hear the stories. Now, I will share with you, there are times there are stories that I don't want to hear again. Some of those stories I would just rather forget. And they're usually the ones that my girls love to remind me of. Well, this morning we leave the Old Testament and we look at the New Testament. Our scripture passage this morning is part of a chain of events, if you will, that takes place following the martyring of John the Baptist at the behest of Herod Antipas. So as we often do, we need to put this passage into perspective. Jesus has heard what had happened to John. And he had tried to withdraw to a place where he could have time to grieve. He needed to grieve the loss of this man who was not only just a colleague in ministry, but John was his cousin as well. But the crowds followed him and he began healing those who were brought to him because that's what Jesus did. As the evening progressed, Jesus will eventually be approached by the disciples who want him to send the crowds away so that they will not be responsible to feed all of them, which we will actually focus on next week as we prepare to celebrate the Lord's Supper on World Communion Sunday. Therefore, we're in essence fast-forwarding, and we will come back to the feeding of the 5,000 next week. Jesus and the disciples have fed that large crowd that had gathered, and Jesus instructs the disciples to get in the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he takes care of encouraging those crowds to go home. As I was doing my research, I read that theologians suggest that after the feeding of the 5,000 and those subsequent miracles that Jesus performed, that the crowds that had gathered intended to make Jesus their king, even if they had to do so by force, which meant that those crowds, even though they witnessed the miracles of Jesus, they still didn't get who he was. But this is actually addressed in the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 14 and 15. Hear these words. Surely this is the prophet who has come into the world. Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. It is also possible that Jesus sent the disciples on without him, as perhaps they were starting to get caught up in the frenzy of the crowds, because we all know what can happen when crowd mentality takes over. But it's also interesting to note that Matthew only mentioned two times that Jesus prays, now and then again in the Garden of Gethsemane. Matthew writes that after Jesus had dismissed the crowd, he finally gets that alone time that he was longing for hours ago. And he goes up on the mountainside to pray. Matthew shares with us that later that night, Jesus was there alone, and the boat was a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. They were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it's me. Don't be afraid. For us to understand the dynamics of what is happening, I would like to share with you some things that I read again while preparing for the message this morning. This is the first time that Jesus sends the disciples on to somewhere else without him. Therefore, it's also not a coincidence that those disciples were in the boat when the storm comes. Now, if we were to look at previous scripture passage, Jesus gets in the boat and he begins to teach, but the disciples are right there with him. We also need to understand the disciples have been in the boat for hours, as it is somewhere between 3 and 6 in the morning. It's also possible that several of them had fallen asleep, as if you've ever been in a boat and the water is calm, the rocking motion is sure to make you a bit drowsy. Many, many years ago, when our kids were quite young, Ed had a boat, and we went down to Shigalemi, and we put in. Kelly was probably about 7, and between my life preserver and her life preserver, we were about this far apart, but she crawled up on my lap, and as Ed drove the boat, she fell asleep. And she missed out on how beautiful the river was because she was snoozing. Nevertheless, in our account, the wind becomes stronger, making the water choppy, and the boat begins to react more violently. I would suggest to you that they would already be exhausted from the previous day's activities, and now fighting waves for any length of time would make that exhaustion worse. Also, being that it's the wee hours of the morning and dealing with that exhaustion, they look out on the water, and coming towards them in the fog of the night or the early morning, this figure appears to be walking on water. Now, I don't know about all of you, but I would suggest to you that their reaction is probably normal for the circumstances, so it would not be unusual that they would cry out in fear. But Jesus quickly speaks to them and tells them not to be afraid, that it is him. But it's the next portion of scripture that I'd like us to focus on for a few moments this morning. Matthew writes that Peter speaks up right away and he says to Jesus, if it's really you, that Jesus should tell Peter to come to him on the water. Now, whether Peter was just saying that to show up, in essence, posturing in front of the other disciples, or he really meant it, we all know we should be careful for what we ask for. So Jesus tells Peter to come. Peter gets out of the boat, he walked on water, and he comes toward Jesus. But we also need to understand that when Peter noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and he began to sink, and he called out to Jesus, "Lord, save me." And Jesus did just that. Jesus says to Peter, "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" Matthew then concludes this account by writing that when Jesus and Peter got in the boat, the wind died down, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." When this passage is used, it's often approached in one of two ways. Either the focus is on the disciples not recognizing that it's Jesus who's walking towards them, or that Peter lacks the faith to keep his eyes on Jesus, and therefore he sinks. But I would like us to take a different approach. I would like to focus on the fact that at least Peter got out of the boat, and what this means to us in our personal life and then in our church lives. First of all, we need to acknowledge that Peter is the only disciple who's willing to do what none of the other disciples are either willing or able to do. And again, I don't think it matters why he asks, whether again it was to show off or whether it was he really, really wanted to do this. But we need to understand the hugeness of what Peter attempted to do, that he had enough faith in the first place to step out of the boat and onto the water. Although we do recognize that Peter soon begins to sink, he was still willing to step out of that boat. You and I as Christians often begin by taking a step out of faith, and as soon as the water gets a bit rough, if you will, we head back to the comfort and security of the boat. You and I, like Peter, have faith strong enough to get us out of the boat, but our faith is often not strong enough to stand up to the storms in our lives. However, we, like Peter, also need to remember that when we cry out to Jesus, he hears us. He extends his loving arms to us. He holds us up out of the water, returning us to the safety of the boat. I will share with you that I believe that the more time you and I spend in prayer, devotions, and worship, the stronger our faith will become, because our relationship with Jesus Christ will become that much more stronger. But here's something else that came to me. I will share with you that I don't believe that there was a harshness in Jesus' voice when he said to Peter, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" As I read this verse of the passage, I pictured Jesus speaking to Peter, much the same as you or I would speak to a child who is frightened, even though we're right there with them. So, sisters and brothers, what does this mean for us in our church lives? We as the leadership know that there have been times that we have stepped out in faith and we've tried something new and it didn't work. Or perhaps it took a while for it to catch on. However, I truly, truly believe that as long as what we are doing is for the glory of God, it will be blessed. It may not happen immediately, but I believe it will happen. It is when you and I take the focus off of Jesus and begin doing what we want to do that we start to sink. When the agenda is no longer about mission and ministry, when the agenda is ours and not God's. We also need to recognize that even when we're willing to step out of the boat, there will be times that we do begin to sink. However, these are the times that we look to Jesus to give us a hand and help us to get back into that boat. We also need to remember that even though Peter began to sink, at least Peter took a risk and got out of that boat. And you and I need to do the same, both in our personal lives as well as our church life. We need to take that risk and get out of the boat. Let us pray. Gracious God, we too are often like Peter. We take that step out in faith to get out of the boat, but as soon as the wind comes, we panic and we begin to sink. Help us to remember that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, so that when the storms of life rage around us, all we have to do is extend our hand to him. Amen. If the ushers will come forward, we will have the giving of our tithes and offering.
gracious and faithful God. Help us to give you not only our finances, but all we are, all we have, and all we hold. As before it was ours, it was and is yours. We open our lives to you for the service of your kingdom. Please work through our tithes and offerings today, our lives this coming week, and lead us to follow you, Christ, in all that we do and say. Amen.
Will you join with me in the closing hymn, number 2191, in the faith we sing, Eternal Father, Strong to Save.
And forevermore, and all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.